So this last bit is not any theory as such. I just wanted to look at a handful of questions that have appeared, just some different ones, a bit more unusual. So this one's quite a while ago now. It's actually an example of variable angular velocity. Okay? And when it actually happened, people were a bit, you know, up in arms about it, because they said, well, hang on, it has to be constant angular velocity. That's what's in the course. How can you have a question on variable angular velocity? And the reason they got away with it is this train is moving around the circle with constant angular velocity. Thing is, there's this other reference point, N, that angle is not moving with a constant angular velocity, and that was the one they were interested in the problem. So basically, you got a nice circular train track, a model train going around it. They defined a few angles there, so TNS is phi, TOS is theta, radius is A, that's X. So there's our picture. First thing, they simply wanted us to find the theta to T, so the angular velocity of theta. Well, we know the length of the arc is equal to A, that's the radius of our circle, times theta. So dl to t is a times the theta to t. Dl to t, well, that's u. That was our linear velocity. That's how they defined it in the problem. So u equals a times the theta to t. So the theta to t is simply u on a. So the first part of the question, reasonably straightforward. It's really, it's just velocity is equal to r times omega, I suppose, is another way of doing it. The second one, a lot more interesting. We need to show that a sine theta minus phi minus x plus a times sine phi was equal to zero, and from that, to work out the rate of change of phi with respect to time. So, rate of change of theta, there's our constant velocity. This is the one that's going to be variable. This is what we've got to find. If you look at the diagram, I'm going to have to define some angles here. So I know NTO plus TNO would be TOS, exterior angle of triangle OTN. So NTO plus phi is theta, making NTO equal to theta minus phi. Basically, I was trying to identify where this angle they're referring to is in the picture. So it's angle NTO. Now, if I use the sine rule in that triangle, I get A over sine phi is A plus X over sine theta minus phi. I should be able to play around with that and get the expression that they want. So cross multiply, bring everything to one side, and we have our expression. We now have to find d phi dt. So I'm just going to differentiate with respect to t. So A... Now we had sine theta minus phi. So the angle theta minus phi, well, that's all right. I'll differentiate it with respect to theta minus phi and I get cos theta minus phi, but that will be times the theta minus phi to t. But I can break that up into two things. But our rules of derivatives say, well, hang on, if I'm differentiating theta minus phi, I can do each bit individually, so that would be the same is going to theta to t minus d phi to t. The other one's a little bit easier because I can differentiate it with respect to phi, which means I have to multiply it by d phi to t. Okay, remember we're trying to find d phi to t. If I expand out my first one here and then I've grouped the d phi to t's together and the d theta t's together, then I've moved the d theta to t to the other side, but I've replaced the theta to t with u on a, which is what we found in part A. And I want to make d phi to t the subject, so now I divide by this a cos theta minus phi, etc., etc., and I've got the expression that they were looking for. It's a little bit tricky, that one. So the next question was, show that d phi to t is zero when nt is a tangent. So if I look at our diagram, if I make NT a tangent, what does that tell me? And the things it tells me, well, angle NTO, I now know must be 90 degrees, because radius is perpendicular to the tangent. Theta minus phi, remember that's the one we identified to be theta minus phi. So theta minus phi is 90 degrees, which means I can substitute in 90 for theta minus phi. Well, cos of 90 is equal to zero. So it actually doesn't matter what the denominator is doing. Top of the fraction is zero. So therefore, phi to t is zero. Got my answer. Okay, they're now saying that x is equal to a. We want to show that the train's angular velocity when theta is pi on 2 is 3/5 the angular velocity when theta is equal to zero. So we'll look at those two situations. First of all, when it's theta on 2. Now, when theta is pi on 2, I've now got a right angle at NOT. And over here, we know that angle's phi. OT is the radius, so I know that length is A. ON is now 2A, because they said X was equal to A. And by Pythagoras, I can work out root 5A. That's now going to allow me to find cosine of phi and things like that. Cosine of pi on 2 minus 5 will be 1 on root 5. Subbing it into our formula that we worked out, there we go, we got u on 5a. So remembering in our formula, this is now 2a, because it was x plus a, and it was theta minus phi, so it's now pi on 2 minus phi. So that's when it's pi on 2, when it's equal to 0. Okay, to phi to t will now be u cos 0 on a cos 0 plus 2a cos 0. Well, cos of 0 is 1. We get u on 3a, which is 5/3 u on 5a, my answer before. So yes, thus it is 3/5 the angular velocity when theta is equal to 0. I suppose the tricky bit there was realizing that all of these angles end up being 0. But if you think of the placement, if theta, which is this angle at the center, is equal to phi, we're talking about a straight line here. T would actually be on ON. All right, let's have a look at this circular motion one, where, again, we have a vertical circle rather than a horizontal circle. I think of this as the yo-yo question. Remember playing with a yo-yo when you do that around the world one, where you go, and you watch the yo-yo go around? That's sort of what I imagined with this question. We're a string of length L, mass of M, so P is now called yo-yo instead of Bob. We're going to show that the tangential acceleration is given by this wonderful expression. S is the length of the arc. It'll equal the radius, L, length of the string, times theta. So we know velocity is ds to t. So it'll equal L times d theta to t. The second derivative will be dv to t, which I could rewrite as dv to theta times d theta to t. I now have dv to theta times v on L. Well, v I'm separating out, because V I'm going to rewrite as d to V of a half V squared. The dV's cancel. 1 on L, d to theta of a half V squared. That may look, I hope, familiar to you. That's, you might remember how I proved the d dx of a half V squared. Basically using the same idea, but using it with our angular velocities there. So, okay. We're going to need that acceleration later. We want to show the equation of motion of P as that lovely expression. So let's have a look at yo-yo. We now have tension. We have mg. You'll notice I've rotated the problem to get the string horizontal, which means gravity now is at an angle. Mg sine theta would be a vertical force now, and ms double dot would be going up, because that's along the tangent. The tangent was perpendicular to the string. So ms double dot is minus mg sine theta. S double dot is minus g sine theta, but we just proved s double dot was 1 on L d to theta over half a squared. So basically, in a weird way, what they're asking is, find the, well, the way we're looking at it, the vertical component of the motion here. Deduce this beautiful expression. Okay. So we've just worked that out. So d to theta over half v squared, I've just simply multiplied both sides by L. So half v squared is gl cos theta plus some constant multiplied by 2. But we were told initially that velocity was capital V. So sub that in to get my constant. Sub it back in, and just doing some factorizing, we can get the expression that they're looking for. Okay. Explain why tension minus mg cos theta is this 1 on L mv squared. Okay, back to yo-yo. If I look at the horizontal forces, tension now looks horizontal. We have a component of gravity, but horizontally, now, circular motion's resultant force now, because I've rotated the picture, looks horizontal. So it's always directed towards the center. So the way I've rotated the diagram, it's now horizontal. So that's my resultant force horizontally. So we're saying that that mx double dot is t minus mg cos theta. But we know it's the centripetal force because it's towards the center, which is mv squared on, well, r, but in this case that's L for length of the string. We got it. There we go. That's all we're looking for. Suppose that v squared is actually equal to 3gl. Find the value of theta of which t is equal to 0. So t minus mg cos theta, 1 on lm, but I've now replaced v squared with the expression that we found, capital V squared, etc. But capital V squared is 3gl, so sub that in. Tension is 0, they're telling us. So I'll sub that in as well. We're trying to find theta. So I should be able to play around with this and make theta the subject. Well, at least cos theta. We're getting there. MGs will cancel. There we go. Cos theta is negative 1/3. So 1.91 radians. So what's that saying? I'm spinning that yo-yo in the circle. But once it's rotated, so it starts at the bottom, once it's rotated 1.91 radians, which would be, that's an obtuse angle, isn't it, if we convert that into degrees, it's about here, tension zero. So in other words, the string has gone slack. What happens when the string goes slack is the next question. So if we're now going to consider that, what happens when the tension becomes zero? Fly off in a tangent, because it's like the tension's not there. If the tension's not there, what sort of motion is it now going to do? It becomes projectile motion. So it was in circular motion, but then when the tension's gone, it's like someone's just got the object and thrown it now, because the only thing it's acting under is gravity. Tension's gone. So it goes into projectile motion. So tension equals zero, it starts going into projectile motion, so it will follow a parabolic arc. Its initial velocity would be tangential to the circle. I might have gone a bit overboard here. With magnitude, well, we could work it out. So I've subbed in the cos. We know tension was zero. The velocity would be the square root of GL on 3. Possibly they didn't want that much information. And then I thought it'd be nice to draw a picture. So look, there it is. It starts down the bottom. It goes around 1.91 radians. The string now goes slack, so it shoots off at a tangent in projectile motion. But then the really nice thing is, what will happen, it can't escape the string. At some point, the string is going to kick back in again. And it will have tension, and it will go back into circular motion. And so if you were spinning, oh, if only I had a yo-yo. Got to use your imagination here. So I'm spinning the yo-yo, and it's going around in a circle. It goes slack, and then it gets, and so because it's back in tension, it's back in circular motion again. And I could keep with this weird sort of motion. I could keep doing that if I wanted to. Let's have a look at this last example here, where it's projectile motion, but taking into account resistance as well. So horizontally, which normally would be equal to zero, now there's going to be resistance in the opposite direction. So we've got acceleration is minus k times the velocity. And the y direction, normally it would just end up being minus g, but now we also have resistance in the opposite direction. So we've got minus kv there as well. So the bit in parentheses is the important bit. You're not required to show these. They've given you those. You don't have to derive them. They've given them. So there's our working point. First thing they want us to do is to work out the horizontal velocity equation. Horizontal. All right. So we were told acceleration in the horizontal direction was equal to minus k times the horizontal velocity. Now we want to get a link between velocity and time. So we'll use dv to t. So t will be minus 1 on k, the integral. Now the initial horizontal velocity is u cos alpha, and we want an equation for velocity. So we end up with, well, it becomes a log function, and eventually, after much rearrangement, because we could get t in terms of x dot, but we want x dot in terms of t. So there we finally get it. U e to the minus kt cos alpha. So this time, for the vertical velocity, they're just asking us to verify it satisfies the equation of motion. And they gave us that, remember, they told us the y acceleration. So all we'd have to do is differentiate this with respect to time and show it satisfies. Unfortunately, I think I misread the question and I actually derived it, but it was fun. Look, here we go, dy dot dt, integrate. We get t in terms of the y dot. So now I want to rearrange it, and eventually, there we go, I got it out. Not what they were expecting you to do, but it does work and it was fun. You could do it the easier way, because all they're saying is verify it satisfies that acceleration equation. So you can start with that and get that. Right. Find when it reaches the maximum height. Well, just because resistance is involved doesn't change the physics of it. We still know maximum height occurs when that y dot is equal to zero. So we want to find that out. Now, of course, I made the mistake of doing it this way. But one of the advantages, I guess, of making that mistake is I already had this integral set up. So I can end up going straight to my integral and say, well, the time will be, we're going from the initial velocity of u sine alpha up until a velocity of zero. Subbing in, and well, a lovely answer, I'm sure you'll agree. 1 on k log ku sine alpha plus g over g. The limiting value of the horizontal displacement of the particle. So we know the horizontal velocity. I now need to get an expression for the horizontal displacement. Now, the limit we want as t approaches infinity. So that's why I've gone, well, actually I've written that probably wrong. I've gone integral from 0 to infinity. Probably more should be 0 to t, and then we're substituting in t to infinity, but trivial point there. Integrate our exponential, and eventually we'll work out our limit. There it is. U cos alpha on k. U cos alpha on k. Okay. Alright. So those were just some examples of some different sorts of questions that have appeared over the years.